Today, we're going to be using a lot of F words such as forge and flux. This is a beginner's guide on how to get started with using forge and flux. I'm also going to be showing you how you can create videos from your images that you create today. So you're going to be learning loads and also tips and tricks along the way. All the links are down in the description below, and I have created chapters down in the description as well that should help you out. So forge is a fantastic user-friendly UI, a great alternative to Comfy UI for those that want a more clean user interface. There's absolutely no subscriptions whatsoever, and you can create as many image generations as your hard drive can handle. Flux One is the latest in AI models. You might have heard of Stable Diffusion before, but the general consensus is that Flux One is a far superior model. You can go from hyper-realistic to anime and also digital painting and everything in between. Flux also excels in creating text within images. I'm also going to be showing you some tools and tricks to get the best prompts out of Flux. Then we're going to be inpainting our images, upscaling, and then finally adding some simple but effective animation to them. So let's kick off with system requirements. So this is going to be a Windows tutorial. You're going to need at least 6 GB of VRAM as a minimum requirement. The more VRAM you have, the quicker your image generation will be. For Forge UI, you'll need at least 1.7 GB of space on your hard drive. And for the Flux model, we're using the condensed Flux model, which is smaller, so between 12 to 17 GB of space available. If you go down in the description of this video, you'll find the link for the installation page for Forge. Once you're on that GitHub page, if you just scroll down until you see the heading installing Forge, where it says click here to download one click package, click there and it will download automatically to your downloads folder. If you navigate to your downloads folder, you will be able to see a 7-zip file. And if you don't have a 7-zip, this is a good time to go and download it so you can extract the content from this file. The link is in the description, and that is a free tool. Simply right click on that zip folder and from the pop-up, just select extract all. From this window, you want to go across to browse, and this is where you find the folder where you want to extract your files to. Now, I'm going to be using my C drive because that's where all my files are kept for my programs. So I'm going to right click here in an empty space, and from the pop-up window, I'm going to click new folder. Now I'm going to give this folder a new name like Forge or Forge UI. This is going to be the top hierarchy folder, so just give it a name that you can remember that your Forge UI is in, and just click select folder, and then simply just click on the extract button. This will extract all those contents to your folder. Once the extraction is complete, just go over to your new Forge folder, and within that folder you should see a file called update.bat. It's important that you just double left click this and run the script, and then just press any key to complete that. Now we can close that window down. Simply just double left click on the run.bat. This is the same way you're going to enter Forge every time you open it up. Now I don't want to get too technical or anything like that, but I just want you to know what the two windows are about. When you start up Forge UI, you'll notice firstly you have this user interface here, and then you have a command window. Command window is essentially monitoring every process that the UI is making. So when you're generating images and you flip back to the command window, you can see how far along the process is. This is important for any errors that might occur. If you can't see the error being reported on the front end of the UI, you can usually see in the command window here the errors come up and what the problem is related to. If you come from an automatic 1111 background, this might feel very familiar to you. Forge is forged out of the bones of automatic 1111 with improved speed and performance and a Gradio UI, and also it's optimized for your GPU. Now we have everything installed for our UI, we now need to go and grab our model. This is the thing that's going to be generating our images, and the model we're going to be installing is called Flux One by Black Forest Lab. If you just follow the link in the description below, under number 2 is the link to the Flux models that we're going to be downloading. If you scroll down the page and stop where you get to Flux checkpoints, You can see here that there are two versions, the NF4 version and the FP8 version. So depending on how much VRAM you have, so if you've got 6 to 12 gigabytes of VRAM, you go for the NF4. This is actually the developer's recommended version anyway, because it's very fast. If you've got 12 to 16 gigabytes or higher, go for the FP8 version. And if you're greedy, just go for both and switch between the two. Now, these are actually condensed versions of the original RAW Flux file. You can download the GGUF, which is the RAW Flux file, from here, but you will have to install additional items like T5, VAE, and some tensors and stuff. But you can follow those instructions down there below if you want to do that. However, my advice is to use the condensed versions because they are fantastic and you don't have to have 28 gigabytes of space on your hard drive to be able to run them. So it's up to you, but I suggest using the NF4 if you're not sure about anything. Just download that one. Simply right click on the link, click on save link as from the pop-up, then find your Forge folder, web UI, models and Stable Diffusion, and just save your model in there. Okay, if you just fire up Forge by going to that run.bat file and double clicking on it, and then you'll see in the checkpoint drop down, if you drop down from there, your two flux files, or one flux file, so NF4 or FP8 version. So select one of those. If you don't see any files in there, just hit refresh, which is the blue button on the right hand side. Now let's go over to the left hand side of this screen and look at underneath UI. You can actually now switch between Flux and Stable Diffusion in Excel, so you can actually load in multiple models onto your Forge and switch between the user interfaces of them, which is very handy. So we just need to switch to Flux here. A sanity check is to check that we have set everything up correctly. I've actually lifted these settings straight from the developer's webpage just so we can make sure everybody's output image looks exactly the same and there's no ghosting issues or tiling issues or any issues that you encounter. So if you go down into the description below under step number 3, you will see all the sanity check settings that you will need to input. You can just copy and paste them from the page there. Input the prompt astronaut in a jungle, cold color palette, muted colors, very detailed and sharp focus. So we're going to come down to sampling method and leave it as Euler. That will be as default. And then the width and height, the width is 896 and the height is 1152. The sampling steps keep at 20. This is all pretty default. You don't need to probably change any of this here. This distilled CFG is 3.5 and the CFG scale is 1. And the seed itself, so that's going to be just 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, we're now going to hit generate and hopefully you have an image like this on your screen. If you're having any issues generating your image, if it's blurry or just not even generating images, the first port of call is just to check your command console, that other screen that you have. Just look at the bottom line, see if there's any errors there. Now there are those of us that just want to quickly put beautiful woman, cyberpunk, and generate an image, and it will create you a nice image. And then there are those of us that have a particular vision in mind and we want to create that. So my first tip is to collect references images and get inspired by artwork that you see around you, whether that's on Pinterest, on the Civit AI, or on Google itself. Collect these images on a mood board, and one of my favorites is PureRef. It's absolutely free and the link is in the description. Another great place to go for inspiration is to the Civit AI website. So this is where you can download models and images and LoRAs and all that sort of thing, but also it provides a lot of inspiration. If you click on an image you like, on the right hand side you'll see a little panel that says generation data. Under here it usually shows the prompts that they've used. They've also show the LoRAs that they've used and what type of model, whether it's Stable Diffusion or if it's Flux. So this will help guide you if there's a particular style that you like. I have some free tools that will help you write your prompts. So the first tool we are going to look at is the Flux Prompt Generator. This is absolutely free and works in your browser. You choose everything from art styles, camera types, camera angles, to stylization backgrounds, and even specific artists to reference. Once you've selected all the elements you want, you can leave some blank if you want. You just hit Generate Prompt and it will create a fully formed prompt for you to use with Flux. You can just copy and paste that into your Forge UI and just use that and fine tune that to your liking. Another prompt generator that's slightly simpler but helps you create prompts is called Zero Gen Light. This version is absolutely free. You can just type in elf girl and then just select from the generator to be flux one and submit, and it will create you a detailed prompt for you to just copy and paste into your Stable Diffusion and then adjust it from there. So I've put a prompt in here. If you want this prompt, you can go to my website and just copy it from there. The sampling method, I'm just gonna keep on Euler. And if we go to sampling steps here, I'm gonna increase it to 40. This is gonna add more detail into my image. The higher the sampler, the more detail, but the image can fall apart, so just be aware. Also, it will increase the length of time that your image will take to generate. Next, we'll move down to the height and width dimension. So this can be your aspect ratio, so what size you want your overall image. Now remember, depending on your aspect ratio, the AI is going to create the best composition for your image. So you'll find if you change it to wallpaper size, it's going to spread the image out, or maybe portrait wise, it's going to be a lot more of a taller image. You might even find Flux performs better at different dimensions than others. Alpaca on Reddit actually did an experiment. The results are here. If you wanted to use the rounded dimensions here, go ahead and try them out. I'm going to increase the batch count to 6 so I can cherry pick the best image. And I'm going to keep the CFG distilled at 3.5. Now, if you're finding your images of your realistic characters are too waxy, decrease this, lower it down, and that should get rid of that waxiness on your characters. So coming down to the seed, I'm going to leave mine at -1. This will create a similar image, but every time it creates an image, it will just be a slight variation on the one before. So I'm going to hit generate, and this will take approximately about 6 minutes for 6 images at this resolution. Now, this will change depending on your GPU and if you're using any programs in the background, etc. You'll see down here at the bottom of your image all the details and the setting of your images, as well as how long the image generation took. If we're looking through these images, I quite like them. There's a few errors that I want to fix with inpainting. So if you've got multiple fingers, I mean more than 6, you can easily adjust that with inpainting, or if there's an issue or something you don't actually like in the image, we can go and fix that. To get your image into inpainting, you just press this little palette below the image. It's like a paint palette icon. Just give that a click and it will take you to inpainting. Now you can either use an image that you've just generated, or you can load up any image and do inpainting on that. If you hover your cursor over your image, you'll see this little UI bar come up. So the first option is just to scale into your image. The second one is to load up an image from your PC. The third one is to delete your image and to recenter your image. The next one is to reset your mask, and then you've got undo and redo. The little bar at the bottom below it is to increase your mask size brush. So you're going to use your cursor just to brush over the areas that you don't like, whether it's an eye or a piece of hair. You can change that area completely. It's a bit like the tool in Photoshop, pretty much the same thing. So you just brush out the area of concern, and for me it's the lower arm section. It doesn't make any sense anatomically to what's going on in the image, so I just want a bit of cloth there. Okay, I'm going to set my mask blur to 8. That's just the radius around the actual mask and how much that blurring into the original image. The mask mode is going to be in paint mask. The mask content is going to be original. Now, depending on what you're trying to create, you might want to go on to fill or latent noise, but original tends to work the best, so I stick with that until it doesn't. In paint area, I'm going to put onto the whole picture, and then everything else is going to just stay the same. Now we come down to denoising strength. This is really important. The higher the denoising strength, so let's say 0.95, the more the image is going to change from the original. The lower, let's say 0.2, that means that the image or the new image that you're creating over the mask area is not going to change that much. So you'll probably find it's dependent on the image you're creating that you'll need to play around with this to get it right. So if you come and see my prompt here, I have adjusted it to what I actually want to see in the masked area. You can alternatively just take the original prompt and add in additional prompts, like what you want to see, like red hair or whatever you're putting into your masked area. So just try out both ways to see which is most effective for your image. Okay, I'm just going to hit generate, and that's given me 3 images there to choose from. You can go on and add more sections of in painting. My advice is to do 1 section at a time. So once you're happy with one area, move on to the next. Okay, so once you're happy with your image, let's go ahead and upscale it. go down below your generated image, you'll see a little picture frame. Give that a click. That will send your image to the image to image tab, which you can see up here. You can actually just get to it by there as well. If we scroll down, we can see the resize tab. Now you can actually input your dimensions manually, but an easier way to do this is to go to resize by, and you can just put your scale up and increase that. So I'm going to make mine twice the size, so I'm just going to increase it by 2. You can see the resize factor here down at the bottom, where it's going from and then what it's increasing it to. Okay, something so important, the denoising strength. You need to set this as 0 because we don't want any change in the image, we just want to upscale it. So you will have to make sure that is set at 0, very important. Then if you click generate, it will just take a few minutes depending on the size of your resolution and your GPU, and you will now have your upscaled image. Right, we're now going to go to Civit AI and explore what LoRA models they have. If you don't know what a LoRA is, it's a predetermined style. So whether that's a character, if you want the same or similar character, or if it's wearing the same outfit, or if it's a particular style, whether that's like 3D, illustration, or watercolor, or, oh goodness me, I don't know, anime, whatever you're looking for, it will be there. So I'm going to be using the retro anime flux style, so you can just search there. On the left-hand side, if you filter by base model, and that will be Flux 1 Dev for you guys, and then underneath, go to filter model type and just find LoRA, and that will filter all the models that are compatible with what your setup is. As I said, I'm going to be using the retro anime, and just going to click on that one. In the details panel here, you can just check the base model again and the fact that it's a LoRA. Usually these have trigger words, or sometimes they have trigger words which you need to put into the prompt as well to activate the LoRA, but in this case we don't, so we can ignore that. It's always good to read the developer's notes as well, because this here recommends a certain strength and not to go over that strength, because you'll end up with fuzzy images. Now if you want inspiration, go down and you'll see what other people have created with that LoRA itself. Just make sure that you're signed in before you download, and then right click on the download arrow and then save link as, and just save that in your Forge folder, web UI, models and LoRA. If you head back into Forge UI and then find the LoRA tab over here and come down, you'll need to go over to this refresh button here. Click on that and you should now see your new LoRA that you've downloaded here. Click on your LoRA and you'll notice a little tagline appear in your prompt area. Underneath here, we're just going to switch back to the generation tab and we can start using our LoRA. Just added a prompt here. You can grab this from my website if you really wanted to, and it's alongside my tag here. Now you can see it says 1:1. You can decrease that strength to, let's say, 0:8, and that will lessen its effect on the actual prompt. And you can increase that. Remember, it said in the developer's notes, I think it said maximum 1.2, otherwise you'll start getting some crazy images. I'm just gonna generate that, and this is what I got. If you saw my Twitter post with this, where it was animated, as well as my Instagram, this is the exact same prompt I use. Now if I change the aspect ratio and then hit generate again, you can see the composition hugely changes the overall image. So again, that's what we looked at before. Let's do something quite fun now. Let's turn these images into videos. So I'm going to be showing you a comparison between three of my favorite web services. The first one is Haleo AI, and this is what it looks like. It's all very similar and they all are very simple to use. You just upload an image and then prompt. You don't even need to write a prompt, to be honest, and then you can submit and see what it generates. And then we've got Luma Labs AI, which resulted in this. And then we have Kling AI, which resulted in this. Okay, that did the dirty on Kling AI. However, if I removed the prompt, the video was actually a lot better. And yes, as you can see, it significantly improved there. You will get a lot of duffed video generations doing this, so don't worry about that. I have many, but this is just the tip of the iceberg. So there's going to be room for a lot of error, and it's going to look pretty bad for a couple of weeks until it's really, really good, and then we're on to the next thing. I really want to do a more of an advanced video on the AI animation. You can obviously use end frames and start frames and camera movements and all that sort of thing, so I'll be doing another video just on that. But now you've got Forge and Flux set up, you can create all the images for the start and end frames for your AI animations. But with that said, I hope you've enjoyed this video. Remember, everything is on my website, which is promptmuse.com. You can go and get all the links from there. Please subscribe to this channel. That helps me more than anything. Thank you so much for joining me once again on this magical adventure. I hope you've learned something from this. If you've got any comments or any tips for myself or others, please put in the comments section below. And if you create any videos or any images, please at me at PromptMuse, because I absolutely love seeing what you guys create. And just keep learning, keep creating and all that. And until next time, that will do.